text of our gospel is plastered everywhere. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that all who believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You see this at sporting events everywhere, right? John 3:16. You need, that's right. Exactly, Carol. In our familiarity with this quote runs short shrift against the richness of the chapter. We glaze over the fact that John 3:16 is a part of a conversation that Jesus has with Nicodemus, or we whiz right by the importance of Jesus being lifted up. It'd be a shame to walk right past those things. Fortunately, in this sermon, we won't. We won't because in many respects, our lives are like Nicodemus. How are we like him? I suppose every one of us here this morning knows what it's like to be disturbed. You know, being kept up late at night by a feeling or emotion that won't let you go, fear that prances on your bed, anxiety that does quick tempo in the dark, a gnawing that even though things might appear to be right in your world, there is just something that is out of sorts. You know the feeling? Nicodemus did. That larger-than-life man, that leader in the temple who had wealth and power and all the trappings of the world that make for the good life, got up in the middle of the night, jumped into his limo, and drove under cover of darkness to see Jesus. Rabbi, he says to Jesus, I know you're from God because no one can do the things of God that you do. And in response, Jesus lays his life bare, offering this frightening freedom and a life of God that goes beyond his imagination or Nicodemus' ability to be able to procure it in the normal earthly human ways. And this disturbs him. What do you mean I'm going to be born again? What do you mean you're going to be lifted up? And it should disturb us. Lent is a time to think about different possibilities. Other nourishment, other loyalties. To quote Walter Brueggemann, in various ways we are all seduced, domesticated, bought, economically, religiously, intellectually, politically, morally. It's the story of our life. And here's the rub that really just gets me. Bought people never have power for life. And yet, real life, deep life, eternal life is what God is offering. How do we get into that? What will it cost me? And how does that reflect, how does that affect my relationship with my neighbor? Glad you asked. Jesus responds to Nicodemus and us by talking about many things, but coming back to our text this morning, one of the things he says is that he must be lifted up just as Moses has lifted up the serpents in the wilderness. Now, that reflects back to the Old Testament text you heard this morning. God's angry at Israel, and God sends snakes. Or as Reverend Carol likes to say, snakes happen.
Right.
They, in turn, complain to Moses, and Moses complains to God. This is a pattern you see over and over again in the Old Testament text. And God says, make this bronze statue. When people are bit by the snakes, lift up the statue. They're going to be just fine. But you notice that God doesn't get rid of the snakes. We have snakes too. And the snake that has bitten us is called death. We're all going to die. Yet, mysteriously and lovingly, Jesus embraces death and, just like the golden snake that provides life, Jesus' death provides life for us, not just in any old fashion, but eternal life that suffuses into our life. God's love is deeper and more mysterious than we are comfortable with, and thankfully, doggedly, will not let us go. In our Dying Well class, one of the things we talked about is that God suffuses that eternal life in the now. You don't know how it happens. You can't necessarily see it happening, although you experience some changes. Even C.S. Lewis talks about this. But that eternal life, when this temporal life goes away, that eternal life stays. I don't quite get it, but it's true. Our natural proclivity, however, is to do as Nicodemus did, is to get into that limousine, slink back to our home, live lives as they normally were, ignoring God's call to life beyond what we can procure, ignoring the mysterious invitation to be born again, to die what is cutting us off from life, to ignore the haunting refrain, now put in proper context, God so loved the world. You know the rest of the text. So the question remains is this. How do we get into what God's offering? It's frightening, it's scary, it's different. How do we get into it? So one way that I think that we can get into what God is offering to us is to take a phrase from a Buddhist, believe it or not, Joan Halifax. She is famous for saying this phrase. I want you to remember this when you go today. The phrase goes like this. Strong back, soft front, wild heart. He said it again. Strong back, soft front, wild heart. I'll explain. Let me begin by being candid that nobody wants what Joan Halifax is offering. Why? Because the world tells us we need a strong everything. But hear me out. We need a strong back because to follow Jesus sometimes means that we have to stand alone. The way of Jesus is at enmity with the world because God's way demands a way of loving God and loving neighbor. You don't get out with one without the other. And as you know, we live in a bifurcated society that says, live in your own silo. It's a good thing. And anything that doesn't match up with that is bad. There are a whole lot of books that have been written about this. If you want to do further reading, I recommend to you Bill Bishop's The Big Sort or Robert Putnam's Bowling Alone. Jesus, on the other hand, tears down the dividing wall, and the only way to move into God's life is to exercise having a strong back that allows us to stand with God even when we're alone. But that's not enough. We also need to have a soft front so that we can embrace others who are not like us. A soft front also makes room for a wild heart. The wilderness of reaching out to those who are different. The wilderness in which we find and are found by God who supplies our need. Now, our Bible is full of all kinds of wilderness stories. Moses and Joshua and Elijah and Jesus, just to make a few points. And rather than us gathering our needs solely from our degrees or our experience or our talents or our abilities, the wilderness is the place where we trust God. It's in the wilderness of the spirit, the wilderness of the heart, that God supplies our needs, and that's a frightening space to live in. However, there is an old outward bounds phrase that goes like this. If you can't get out of a situation, get into it. What we seek when we are confused or afraid is reassurance, and that's not what's needed here. The trouble originates in this almond-shaped portion in your brain called the amygdala. It doesn't speak English, as Seth Godin would say. Rather, it speaks emotions. And the freedom that God offers can be so scary that we can't tell the difference between what's good and what frightens us. The wilderness of the heart can be scary, as I said before, but even though it's scary, lean into the wilderness. Learn to dance with the amygdala. Learn to lean into God who supplies our needs, feeds the birds there, sustains Jesus in the wilderness, who supplies your needs every single day to allow you to be alive. What's that look like when we love God and love others this way? Here's a glimpse. People can be hard to hate up close. Move in.
That's true.
I'll say it again. People can be hard to hate up close. Move in. St. Clair's is a safe community, at least I think so. Dare to move in closer to those that you don't know, even those you might not like very well. Dare to hold hands. Oh, I must have touched something. Dare to hold hands with strangers. A soft heart is a spacious place, unlike living in your anger, or living in your fear, or living in your contentedness. And it leaves us with room to be able to engage in new ways. It gives us new tools. It allows fear to turn. Fear can be the start of courage. That's a place to be able to lean in. It allows anger to be able to turn to curiosity. What might this be like if we think of this differently? That's a place to lean in and to turn. It allows proclivity towards the status quo to become imagination of what could be. That's a place to get in and to lean in. And you don't need me telling you that we are living in some rather difficult times. Anxiety and anger and even despair. It's all around us. On Friday, Diane and I were doing some doctor's appointments over in Vallejo. And then we decided, guess what? Let's go have lunch in Yountville. As we're driving to Yountville, we're looking, we see all these emergency vehicles, and we say, is this a school shooting? You all know how the story ends, right? It's all around. I would much rather respond to all of that with the life-giving power of God than with fear or anxiety or an anger that destroys things. Here's a further point of clarification. An imam by the name of Abdul Antepi gave this lecture. He tells this amazing story. He said there was a Turkish Haredi Sufi who was walking at midnight, and he sees another Haredi Sufi looking for something. And he says, what's going on? He says, I left my car keys. I can't find them. And so the two of them decide to go together, and they're looking for this guy's car keys. They look everywhere. And at some point, the gentleman who was trying to help him says, are you sure that you left your car keys here? He said, no. I don't think I dropped them here. He said, why are we looking here? Why are we looking here? He said, this is the only place that has light. Isn't that like humanity? Isn't that like us? But he goes on, he says, so for many, many questions for people of faith that we are facing in modernity, whether it's empowering women or defeating patriarchy, whether it's empowering and creating respectful spaces for the LGBTQ communities, whether we are defeating the common rise of the voices of hatred and exclusion, some of those answers are already built into our tradition. We know what the answers are. Some of those answers are in places where the tradition is shedding light. That's all good news. But many of those answers are in those dark places where we work. Intellectual work, theological work, spiritual work is not being done. Those are the places we need to be. And it's very difficult for one tradition to go in those dark places alone. We can shape a different kind of theology, walk into those dark places, holding each other's hands together, and glorify God's name in very unique and different ways. Our word is together. That, friends, is the work. Strong back, soft heart. Excuse me, I keep wanting to do that.
strong back, soft front, wild heart. Now, I'm going to push your boundary just a little bit. Will you please take the hand of the person next to you? And if nobody's next to you, find somebody to get next to you. Thankfully, it's you still. Not so fast.
Almost got me.
Almost. Brothers and sisters, beloved and friends of God, we need these three gifts in order to be able to embrace the gifts God has given us and to walk into God's future. Together, salvation is about all of us, not some of us. Sing it with me. Yes, Jesus loves.